Cool. Yeah. Hi, everyone. My name is Josh. Is this working? Yeah. Quickly, I'll give a bit of background about who I am and what brought me from starting my coding journey to right here, right now. I started initially playing with HTML, CSS, a little bit of JavaScript, a little bit of PHP back in 2008. I did a little bit of freelance work, a little bit of experimentation. I went to school for audio engineering and decided I didn't want to do that professionally. It wasn't until 2014 that I went to a Ruby-based coding bootcamp, which I think is kind of a similar program to Code Your Future, at least like in terms of it's a training for software development. It probably deviates in a lot of other ways. But it was a 9 or 10 week full-time program. Shortly after doing that, I got my first job in the industry and I worked as a software developer from 2014 to 2020. I've worked at places like Khan Academy, DigitalOcean, dropping my camera filter thing, and Gatsby and Unsplash, a few different tech companies. I moved around quite a bit and I'm going to talk about that as well. I also, during that time, was working part-time as both like a TA and an instructor at a local coding bootcamp called Concordia Bootcamps. And actually that one I imagine was even a little bit more similar because it was a part-time program over the course of 8 months, which from scouring the Code Your Future website, I gather is kind of similar in its structure. In 2020, I left both of those jobs to focus on creating online courses, and that's what I have been doing ever since. And I should also, I don't think I have a slide for it. I guess that's kind of it. I did this presentation that I'm doing now at a bootcamp a few weeks ago, or a few months ago now, actually. And really, like, what I want to do is just share a handful of things that I've learned, both from, like, my own career, so getting my first job, deciding when to change jobs, how I kind of built my career, how I've sort of built my reputation outside of that through things like social media and blogging. And really, it's just a matter of, like, this is sort of the kind of thing I wish I had had when I was much earlier in my career. So I'm happy to share whatever is useful and helpful. I know Sally mentioned that there's going to be a Q&A at the end of this. So I'm like, I don't know if I have, I probably have like 20 minutes of stuff. So the hope actually is that I'll get lots of questions at the end. So I think that'll be interesting. All right. What have I not said on this slide? I guess that's pretty much it. The other thing I'll touch on briefly is how to learn effectively, because that's something I also think is really important. All right, so getting your first job, asterisk. The asterisk is really important because, you know, I'm just one person. And I do think, like, one of the things I did when I was working for Concordia Bootcamps was I worked as a career coach. And so what that meant was essentially being paired one-on-one with a recent graduate and doing technical interview practice, portfolio review, helping them sort of land their first job, essentially. And I did that with 6 or 8 students. 6 like officially, and then a handful of others that I like kind of assisted with. And so I'm not like an expert. Like, I have my own experience and a handful of anecdotal experiences, but please take everything I say with a grain of salt. Parts of it may be useful and relevant, parts may not. I also should say this is all within where I live in Canada and applying mostly to Canadian jobs and some US jobs. I know that I imagine most of you are in other places in the world, so it may not, I think you're mostly in the UK and Africa or South Africa, if I have that right. Either way, right, things are different around the world, so we'll see how much of that, you can kind of judge for yourself how much of it seems relevant to your own area. Okay, one last thing, one more caveat. My own advice contradicted some of the things that the career coaches at the bootcamp I was working at were advocating for. So there was there's definitely a lot of conflicting opinions, and honestly I think they're all sort of valid in their own way. Those caveats aside, in my own experience and in the experience of students that I've coached, I really find that like the standard approach is like a shotgun approach where you have a target of like, I want to do 75 applications today or this week. You have this high number and it's all about like crossing those items off the checklist. So it's like, let me very quickly build a cover letter. You have a template where you like throw in the name of the company and the name of the industry, and you try to kind of shoot these out as quickly as you can because it's a numbers game. And the more you send out, you know, it's like winning the lottery, like the more chant times you play. And that can definitely work. But in my own experience, I found it's really useful to try and come up with like a small number of companies that you really want to work for and put more time and energy into those applications. Like in my own experience, I wanted to work at Spotify, the music application. And so I built, I can show you this actually. I spent a weekend, maybe even more than a weekend, maybe a week, building an application. Oh, is it broken? It looks like it might be broken. Let's see. No, it's not broken. So I built this little toy app that uses the Spotify API. The idea is you put in an artist that you like, you can play some of their more popular songs. But then the cool part is you can see a list of related artists. So if I click on Cascade, this artist now moves to the center and I can see a list of related artists to this artist. And so the idea is it's a way of discovering new music by moving through this graph of different, and you know, the further you go, the less it has to do with that initial artist. It's not aggregating all of your choices. It's really just showing me, okay, these three artists are related to this one. And I didn't do any of the hard stuff. Like I didn't do any of the data stuff, the algorithm stuff. This is an interface built using Spotify's API. This is something that exists in Spotify, right? Spotify will show you related artists, but I wanted to build an interface for playing with that data. And so, you know, I built this with their API and I published it and I tried reaching out to people that worked at Spotify and I showed it to them to get them talking about it internally at Spotify. And it worked. Like they reached out to me, I scheduled an interview. I feel pretty confident that I could have gotten a job there, but they wanted me to move to Sweden and I was in no position in my life to be moving to Sweden. So I withdrew myself. But I do think that like for the handful of companies that you really want to work for, if that company has a public API, it can be really worthwhile to build something with it because it really helps you stand out. Like when I worked at Unsplash, which was a really small company, I was leaving the company and I was put in charge of hiring my own replacement. So I would go through the inbox of applications that we've received and schedule interviews and do the hiring stuff. And it was kind of amazing to me how little effort most people put into it. And what it meant is that the handful of people that actually like wrote a custom cover letter or knew something about our business, like that they really stood out and it was much, we were much more excited to talk to them and it was a huge advantage for those people. It doesn't necessarily mean that they're gonna get the job, but it definitely is a much better place to start from. Now, I do think like there's a balance here, right? And so one of the strategies I started advocating for is like a spectrum where like create a list of like 4 or 5 companies you really wanna work for, and then like 10 companies that you're like so-so about, and then like 30 companies that you really like, you're not very interested in, and mix these approaches, right? Do the shotgun approach for the companies that you're not super interested in. Use whatever you learn from that to kind of, you know, if you get an interview from that process, then you can learn, you know, the more you practice, the better it is. So you can work towards applying to the jobs that you really want to work for. And I do think like the worst case in terms of building something like this is that like maybe the company isn't hiring right now. And so there's not even a chance for you to apply. Well, you still have this great portfolio project that you can use everywhere. You're not limited to only using it at this one company. So I do think that's a good idea. Along those same lines, right? Writing a personalized cover letter. So this is kind of fun. These are cover letters that I wrote that led to me getting a job offer. So, and I'm not gonna, you know, by the way, I'll include the link. In fact, I think it's even in the calendar invite. So you can go through this all on your own, in your own time. So I'm not gonna go through it literally word by word, but I do wanna show that like Khan Academy is a company I really wanted to work for. And so I wrote this cover letter about how, and this is all true. A few years ago, I built my first web application, which was an educational platform similar to Khan Academy. And because I had, actually it was my boyfriend at the time, but I didn't wanna write that. My partner at the time was working as a tutor teaching high school math and he wanted a way to quiz students. So I built this little tool for him to do that with. And it was a ton of trouble and it barely worked, but it did actually solve his problem. And I thought that was the most amazing thing ever. And then I kind of later on learned about Khan Academy and it was like, oh, this is what I'm trying to do, but a million times better and more established. And so then it was a place that I wanted to work. And so I wrote about that history. I will say, like in retrospect, there is one big problem with this cover letter in particular, which is it really focuses on why I want to work for Khan Academy, but doesn't mention anything about why Khan Academy should want to work with me. Like I'm not talking about why, other than my interest in the subject, which is important. I'm not really talking about why I think I'd be a good fit for this role. And so the second letter is for a company called Glitch. And if you're not familiar, I'll pull them up quickly, which maybe I should have done for Khan Academy too. It's like an online code editor with like multiplayer things where you can get help. You can remix things that other people have built. It's like maybe some of you are familiar with it because it is built for people learning how to code. But I thought this was a really cool product, and I knew some people that worked there, or I knew of some people that worked there. I didn't know them personally, and I thought it sounded really cool. So for them, my cover letter was, my name's Josh, I'm a senior software developer. I currently work at Khan Academy, but I'm super interested in working at Glitch. I've been building web things for as long as I can remember. My first website was a collection of my favorite gifts when I was 11 or 12. Things have changed a lot since then. I've had the luxury of adapting with the internet, but newcomers nowadays have a much steeper hill to climb. I work part-time at a local coding bootcamp, and it's made me realize just how much stuff you need to know to be able to build something that fits into today's web. And so that's like why I think Glitch's mission is important and why I want to work for them. And then I have some bullets about like, here's why I think I would be a good fit at this company. Here are some of the things that I've done. I have these open source projects. Here's what I care about. And I didn't wind up working at Glitch, but they did send me an offer, and I was fielding other, like I eventually worked for DigitalOcean. I was applying to the two at the same time. So I also applied to DigitalOcean. I don't know why this is all small. Let me fix that. That's too big now. And so, like, actually, this is interesting. I was applying to these two jobs at the same time, and they're definitely similar. Like, they both have the same sort of a couple of paragraphs, this little paragraph here. I think I'd be a great fit for the role. Or, like, this sentence is almost the same. But everything, like, it's not, I'm not copy-pasting a template and, like, I am really interested in pasting DigitalOcean because I care about pasting in computers. Right? Like, I'm not doing anything like that. DigitalOcean, I said, my name is Josh. I currently work for Khan Academy, interested in working for DigitalOcean. I've been a DigitalOcean customer for many years, which is true. I really enjoyed how accessible it makes server provisioning and administration. As a mostly front-end developer, DevOps is pretty far outside my wheelhouse, so it's been tremendously useful for me. Empathy is so important for building great products, and I have built-in empathy for enabling folks to build products they believe in without getting drowned by the complaint. Now that I'm reading this again, it's kind of inelegant. Like, I don't think it's actually a great cover letter, but like the point remains that it was a cover letter I wrote specifically for this job, and it did help me get an actual offer and eventually a job there, right? Like I did work briefly for DigitalOcean. I guess I was gonna pause for questions, but I guess I'll wait for the end, but hang on to questions if you have them. Sort of like, again, on the same lines, portfolio sites. Portfolio sites are, I think they can be one of the most important things, and it's for kind of a fun reason, which is I think a lot of developers wonder if it matters. You kind of hear that, like, you know, hiring managers at companies, they get 100 applications a day. They're not taking the time to go out of their way to look at your portfolio site. They're spending 10 seconds on your cover letter and your resume, and that's it. And because this is a belief, a lot of developers just don't build a portfolio site, or they don't spend a lot of time on it. They don't craft something really unique. But I do think there are some small number of companies, or maybe a big number, I don't actually know what the number is. I was certainly, when I worked both for Khan Academy and Unsplash, I was involved in hiring, and I would look at portfolio sites. Some companies do. And because there's this prevailing wisdom that portfolio sites aren't super important, if you have a great portfolio site, it's a really good way to stand out. And that's like, ultimately, you know, when you're applying for your first or second job, that's like what you really need to do, because there are lots of people applying. So anything you can do that like makes yourself stand out among the stack of resumes that someone's looking through is really, really useful. And so I have an example of this. This is someone named Julia. Oh, she changed her portfolio site a little bit. It's slightly different than the last time I saw it. But I think it's amazing because it tells a story. Like it really, first of all, it's beautifully designed. And every project that she lists, like the standard thing people do is they have the title, they have a screenshot, they have a list of technologies that were used, and then like one or two sentences about that project. Whereas what Julia does is she has a page that shows everything about this project. Like this is all just for one project that we're looking at here. You see this really often in design. In fact, this may, oh, she's working as a designer now. Okay, yeah, because I haven't actually seen this project. Let me check this one. Okay, that's interesting. She was like a developer that liked design when this was a couple of years ago that I interviewed her about this. And you see this all the time in design portfolios, but you almost never see it in developer portfolios. And every now and then when I see this, it's super impressive. And it's really useful. And granted, it looks a little bit different. Like this is very focused on screenshots and design things, which isn't really what you want to do as a developer. As a developer, what I think you want to do is talk about, what is this project? Why is this project important to me? Like, why did I choose to build this? What were the technical challenges I ran into building this? Like, what went wrong? What hurdles did I hit? And how did I solve those problems? Like, what did I learn? what was the like technological breakthrough that I had that helped me understand the tools that I'm working with and allowed me to build this project successfully? Just giving people a window into your process, right? Like that's when someone looks at your portfolio site, they're trying to work out a few different things, and it really depends like who's looking at it. But like one of the most common things is, what does this person like to work with? And do they actually know their stuff? And you can answer both of those questions with a really well done portfolio site, because you can give them a window into your process and show them that you know your stuff, because you built this really cool thing, and here's why it was difficult, and here's how I overcame those difficulties. So I do think like the portfolio site is an underrated asset for junior developers particularly. I do have I have a book about this, which is a free book. You can go to my website, joshwcomeau.com/effective-portfolio. I don't think I have a link in this, but I will add one. I'll add one if I don't to the last, because the last slide I have links to things. So I'll add that if I haven't already. But it's like a 70-page ebook. It's free. You do have to give me your email address, but you can, like, if you don't want to hear from me, you can totally like put your email in, download the book, and then immediately unsubscribe. The email that sends you the book should have an unsubscribe link in it. And if it doesn't, let me know and I'll gladly, like, in fact, I'll just tell you, you can go to /download book and skip this process altogether and just get the PDF if you want. So yeah, that's a resource that digs really deeply, and I'll just briefly show it to you because I think it's maybe worth looking at. You know, it's not long, but I mean, it looks kind of long now. I think it's 70 or 80 pages. But it digs in. In fact, it even has screenshots of Julia's original. Let's look at that, because that's more useful than her current one. So like, this is one of her projects that was on her website, Coffee by Benjamin, short paragraph about it, the stack that was used, React, GraphQL style component, Shopify, Netlify, screenshot of the thing, project purpose and goal, a couple paragraphs about like why this was a good project, web stack and explanation, a look at like why she chose the tools that she did for this project, some more screenshots of it, problems and thought process. So like a look at the different problems. In fact, I think this could be a little bit more expansive. This is kind of like, this is, I think, one of the more interesting parts, and it's pretty sparse, but still like it's there, and I love that it's there. Lessons learned, and then links to other projects. Like that's amazing, right? Like something like that really helps someone understand, because there's so little information in the standard thing where you have like dashboard application, a screenshot of a dashboard built with React style components, a dashboard that shows different statistical, like we have no idea why you built this, how much of this you actually built versus how much is like a template or a tool that you used. You know, like there's just, it's very opaque. And so if you can give someone a little window into how that thing was built, I think it's really useful. Playing to your strengths. So this is interesting. A few years ago on Twitter, in 2020, I asked, if you work as a developer and don't have a college degree, I'd love to hear about the story of how you got your first job, what convinced employers to take a chance on you. And I got like 450 responses from people sharing their story about like how exactly they broke into this industry without any sort of like advanced degree. And I took all those responses and I categorized them into like different buckets. And so there's a whole bunch of these different, and honestly, like these buckets, I found like two things. One is that all of these numbers here add to more than 100%, because some people fit into multiple buckets, so I added them to both. But also like the bucketing process was really hard to like everyone's story is totally unique. And these buckets are sort of like if you have a scatter plot of a bunch of dots and I'm just drawing broad shapes around them to try and fit them into these groups. All of that said, I do think it's useful. 7% of people got their first job by literally starting their own business and employing themselves. And it's kind of a good hack actually, but like you work for, you don't even have to like register a company, just do some freelance work, give your company a name and then list that you worked at this company. Like you don't have to write, but like I founded this company, as long as it's like, I'm not advocating lying. So like you should actually like, don't just write that you worked at a company that you never did. But like if you spent a few weeks freelancing or building your own products or whatever, you can totally just like omit the fact that you were self-employed and give your business a name. And like in a lot of these cases, I'll actually look at some examples. Matt Kane, who I worked with at Gatsby, started a company and hired myself. Nobody else would hire a 20-year-old chef who left school at 16. I wish I had more examples here, but this was 7%, right? So it's the smallest group out of all of these. Internship. Some people, like Monica said, I had taken miscellaneous CS classes and learning on my own. I did an internship and then transitioned. Oh, I didn't want to do that. and then transitioned to full-time, I felt like I was at a point in my learning where a bootcamp wouldn't have been valuable, but I didn't have 3+ years of engineering work experience. Yeah, internships are really common. I would say, like, you should be paid for your work. So, like, don't take an unpaid internship. Any company that's trying to hire you as an unpaid intern probably has a bunch of other things that make you, like, it wouldn't be a good experience. So that's what I'll say about that. A bunch of people transition from a different field, which I think is, like, super common, but the stories are interesting. So I'd worked for the company doing technical support in customer experience and learned as much as I could, hoping to one day get a dev role. I saw an opening online while looking for other jobs and figured I'd take a chance. I'm now almost 6 months on a career I worked 5 years for. So, like, if you happen to work in, like, QA or tech support or any sort of, like, not even necessarily, like, any role at a company, if that company has a software development division, like, see if you can, you know, because I think it makes a lot of sense that companies, they care about your technical proficiency, but they also just want to know that you're, like, a dependable person, that you're a good worker, that you're not going to cause problems. And they know all that already if you already work for them in a different field or in a different area. This person says, no degree senior engineer here. My first job was working for an agency web design company doing phone technical support. Over time, I increased the technical responsibilities and moved to new jobs doing more and more development. Self-taught, spent all my time learning. It was 2007. I was an account manager at a direct mail house, and my client wanted to start sending emails. I was dabbling in dev, had a site and played the hell out of Notpron. I don't know what that is. So I showed the CAO my site and explained the table-based code it was built with, and he let me run mail heart icon. I don't fully understand this, but the gist is coming across. Another category is referrals and community involvement. This is actually, let me see what percentage this is. And again, right, these are all my own buckets. And again, like, I think I wrote this in the article. There's no like hard science here. This isn't statistically significant. I'm not doing like a controlled study. This is just anecdotally asking people on Twitter. But yeah, this, where I'm losing my place. Referrals and community involvement. So Kara says, the biggest thing though was there's a second tweet here. Demonstrated another project where I had learned how to TDD as well as a more fun personal DR app. During the take home, I used TDD. The biggest thing though was that I had worked hard on my networking. I'd never been the most extroverted person, but by meeting people, they could advocate for me. Was in college when I got my first job. A professor had referred me for a co-op. Turned into a full-time, so I dropped out. 3 months later, decided to move to Toronto and used meetups, Slack communities, etc. to find a referral. Applications never led to interviews, referrals always did. And this, I think, is a good point, that, like, when I worked at companies, in fact, pretty much every company I've worked for, the referral was never about, like, oh, you know this person, so we're gonna just send them an offer right away. It usually is a pretty minor thing. It's not, unless you've, like, worked with, like, you know, there's qualities of referrals here too. If you work for someone for 5 years, and then that carries a lot more weight. If it's like, oh, I know this person and it seems like they're doing good work online, it's not like a direct line to an offer, but it is often a direct line to an interview, right? You can, and this is, again, like standing out from the stack of resumes on the person's desk. It is a good way if you can meet somebody in like a Slack community or a Discord community, or if you go to a local meetup and you meet someone there. These are great ways to like have your name brought up within a company, which always carries more weight than if you're just another email in the inbox. And then the final and most popular category, which could arguably be two categories, but I've grouped them together, side projects and freelancing. So Kenza says, towards the end of my psychology degree, I took up some online classes in iOS dev. I had a friend who had an app idea, and I made that app to practice, put it on the app store, ended up getting 2 offers before graduation, an app they could play with, impressed employers. And I think this is a really good point. Like the best portfolio projects are real ones. And by real, I don't mean like, oh, it's we have 10,000 monthly active users and we have there's a whole business. I just mean that like something that exists in the world that is tactile, that can be used, even if there's no one actually using it, or if there's like 1 or 2 people using it, it shows a lot more if it's like a real, complete, working, like real life project versus like, I built this thing specifically because I needed something on my portfolio and not a single person outside of myself has ever used it. Right. Those are good too. It's better to have that than nothing. But like the best case is I had this idea for a project. I built the project and now you can visit it at this URL and see for yourself that it's like a real thing that has at least some amount of real users using it. It's always, I think, a little bit better. One more example, made a music app for Facebook's brand new app platform in 2007. It was a terrible spaghetti code, but it did well and got me a job offer from Project Playlist, rest in peace, a year later. super lucky they didn't ask me any technical questions, much imposter syndrome, loss of learning on the job. Let's go one more, actually. I did say people without advanced degrees, so I'll skip this one. I'll skip this one too. My question was like people who graduated without a CS degree, and I'm realizing now that's still like these people still have some sort of college degree. But I do think, yeah, like this is a good example. They have a photojournalism degree, which is still a degree, but not, you know, it's far enough unrelated to technology that it's not likely to help them a ton. I built websites for friends, family, and fun before getting my first real job. Having a portfolio and being knowledgeable about web development helped them feel comfortable. All right. I think that was my last category. Yeah. There's personality and skill set, which I think I remember is my umbrella category for like literally everything else. Like if it wasn't one of these other things, often it did just come down to like some sort of unique story or their personality that really helped them out. So this person says, I showed passion and dedication through how much I had learned in my spare time while being a full-time teacher. I had also recently focused on web accessibility, and this was a huge area for my now employer. Yeah, I don't think I have this in my presentation, but any sort of niche skill you can build that is generally missing, like, you know, when you think about, let's take front-end development as the example, because that's the thing that I know the most about. React is like the big one. JavaScript is really important, right? Angular maybe. And then there's like a whole bunch of skills that are really important, but generally not as common in front-end JavaScript developers. Things like CSS, accessibility, data visualization. Those are the only things that come to mind, but there's like presumably many others that are specialty skills. I mean, really CSS and accessibility should be like, I don't want to say that because that is like every project needs those things. But nevertheless, they are missing from most people who do front-end development. And so if you can be really strong in these areas, you know, like this is another thing. There's this weird, there should be like a name for this, where like you hear a recommendation, like employers care about React. And that means everybody goes and focuses on this one thing. And now like there's, and let's assume there's some truth to it. Like, let's say that is the number one priority that employers have. Employers have like number two and number three priorities. And because everyone is focusing on the number one thing, if you're like decent at the number one thing, but then really strong at their number two and number three priorities, that's like a pretty compelling case, right? And we're at a point now where like so many people are really good at those number one things that that's not really a distinguishing factor anymore. I mean, it's still important because they care about it. But I think it's interesting that like finding, you know, let's say that you're not as strong in that area or you're just more interested in these other areas. You can really build a compelling advantage for yourself by focusing on those things that not many other people are focusing in. And again, like it's not going to work for every employer, but you might find that one employer that really cares about this thing that you're really good at and has had trouble filling that spot because there just aren't a lot of people that are good at it. That's totally like an interesting way to get your foot in the door as well. Okay, stand out for the crowd. I think when I built this slideshow, maybe I had something else to say about that, but I think I've covered that pretty well here. Yeah, so this is another one of my like controversial recommendations. I change jobs every 1 to 2 years. In fact, honestly, my first job, I was there for 2 months. It was an internship and it was paying me, I think, $100 a week, which was like really not good by local, you know, most local companies would have given you like where I was in Toronto, a typical starting salary would have been like 60,000 Canadian dollars a year, which is like 40,000, 45,000 USD. And, you know, $100 a week is obviously much less than that, but it was a first job, so I took it. I didn't stay there very long. I moved to a company called Conrad Group, which was a services-based company. I think my salary there was something like $55,000 or $60,000. I was only there for 3 months as well because I started seeing somebody that lived in Montreal, and this was in Toronto, so I moved and changed jobs at the same time. I did change jobs very frequently. Like, the longest in my eight-year career now was I spent 2 years at Khan Academy. Like, that's the longest I've spent anywhere. And I do recognize, like, let me first say, like, I don't want to assume that something that worked for me will work for everybody, right? Like, I don't want to overgeneralize and say that my experience was typical, but I haven't seen, even with the people that I've mentored, which, you know, is often, I'll acknowledge this explicitly because I think it's important. I'm a white guy that kind of looks like a computer person, and obviously that feeds into people's biases. And so like that could give me advantages that not everyone has when it comes to things like this. But in my career coaching, I worked with people who did not look like me, right? People of color, women, minorities in tech. And I did find that like, even in their interviews, this was not something that was commonly brought up as like, well, I see here that you, you know, you changed jobs after 3 months. I think people fear that it's going to build a reputation as them being flaky or unreliable. Again, everything I'm saying should be taken with a grain of salt, because I'm realizing as I'm saying this that this could be terrible advice. Because again, regional, right? Like I'm thinking about my own region, it hasn't been an issue. Maybe different cultures have very different points of view with this kind of thing. But I do think that just from the growth perspective, like one thing when I was at a boot camp, the instructor, actually, let me do this. I think this will be fun. I'm gonna go to jspaint.org, which is a, maybe that's wrong. Is it jspaint? Let me just Google it. jspaint.app. This is the old school Microsoft Paint. I just need some way to draw because that's what this is. So like what he drew on a whiteboard was he drew a graph. Let me use the line tool for this. And the idea is that like this is time, right? So like this is like, I don't even want to put dates on it right now. Let's say actually, yeah, let's say that these are years. So like this is year one, this is year two, this is year three. The amount that you learn from a job in general looks something like this. Like when you first start, you're learning a whole bunch. And then the longer you stay at a company, you know, you're getting more and more comfortable with the technology that they use. And so the rate of how much you're learning really kind of tapers off. And what my instructor at this bootcamp's suggestion was, you want to change jobs like here. Like you don't want to wait until you're at the stale part of the curve. Because when you change jobs, often at the like 1 to 2 year mark, like it's really anywhere in like this area is what I think he meant. You know, then your graph looks something like this because you get your second job and your third job. And so by 2 years, you know a lot more. It's off the charts, literally. You know a lot more than someone that stayed at a job for 7 years. And there's always exceptions. Like if you work at a company that has lots of different projects within it, like especially if you work at a services company, like if you work at a company that's constantly taking on new clients and building new projects from scratch, that's a bit of an exception because then you really are starting new things all the time and you're learning different technologies and you're experimenting with new. But if you're working on like a product company, like if you work at Netflix and you spend 7 years in the ad department maintaining the same application, there's only so much you can learn from that project and you squeeze out all that learning within the first couple of years, or most of it. So yeah, just a bit of advice that I wanted to forward along. Network, I'm realizing now, I thought I had 20 minutes. This is talking a lot more than I thought. Sally, how long are we, like, what is the time, like, how much time do we have left?
We can go for another 20 minutes.
Okay.
So don't worry. Finish your talk and we'll take questions. And if people have to leave, they have to leave. And if you have to go, that's also fine.
Okay. I don't have anything. I can stay for as long as we need. So that's cool. My ending. Yeah, totally. If people want to drop off, that's totally understand. Networking. I do think like when I was getting started, this is what I wanted to say when I had, playing to your strengths might've been one of the things, maybe I don't have a slide for it. When I was getting started, I went to the bootcamp and one of the advice from the bootcamp, was really to, go to networking events. So like there was this, it doesn't matter. There was this group that would do these monthly meetups. There was Rails pub nights, and so every month the Rails community would go to a bar. I am not like a bar person. I'm also not like a being in groups person. So I would go to these events and I would be like quietly sitting in the corner and just like be looking at my watch or my phone, waiting until it was time to leave. And like there was no universe in which this was good for my career. Like it makes no sense, right? Like I wasn't gonna land any jobs by going to a bar and sitting and maybe like talking to the one or two people I already knew. I don't have the gregariousness to go and approach strangers and network and be really, it's not who I am. So I do think that when people hear networking, they assume that it's that, right? It's going to meetups, shaking hands, schmoozing people. And it could be like, if you're very extroverted and you're charming and like, totally, that's a viable route. But like networking as a category is a much broader umbrella than just that. For myself, I really like building things. And so my version of networking was get a Twitter account, build stuff, and then show people what I was building. And that's part of this idea of learning in public, right? I started a blog on Medium because I liked the idea of like when I learned some new thing, I would share it with people. And so it was just a matter of that was the kind of networking that was comfortable for me. And that's the kind of networking that really helped me in the end. There are some exceptions, like with Khan Academy, I did go to a hackathon and I met someone at the hackathon that then put a referral for me internally at Khan Academy. But I think that actually mattered a lot less than the fact that I had contributed to Khan Academy's They have an open source project called Aphrodite, and I had started contributing to that. I think that obviously, I guess I shouldn't assume, but it would, based on what I knew, joining the company and working there and seeing our process for other people, that seemed like the kind of thing that we put a lot more weight into than just like, hey, I met this person at a hackathon and they're applying. So yeah, I do think that networking can be like much broader than people think. And you can totally play to your strengths. Like if you really like building things, then that can be how you network, right? Just take a little bit more time to share what you're building. This is also a big thing, like giving before you take. There are lots of people who reach out to me on Twitter, people I don't know, who they're stuck on a problem and they want my feedback on this thing. They want my help. It doesn't really build goodwill, right? Like if the first interaction I have with someone is them asking me to spend my time to help them in a way that doesn't benefit me at all, I might do it. Sometimes it might be fun and interesting, but I'm not likely to like have an ongoing relationship and for me to like then want to help this person as much, like, you know, like it doesn't really build a relationship. And I think a lot of people go about this a little bit the wrong way. So I do think like the way to network is to, like, if you find something that someone would be interested in that you think they would benefit from, share it with them. If you see someone asking a question and you know the answer to that question, answer that question. You know, try and provide value to the people that you're in your network so that that person says, oh, wow, that was really useful or helpful, or like, and then, you know, later on you can start asking them questions, and like there's totally like a balance there. I'm not saying never ask anybody anything. And by the way, like if anyone in this group wants to ask me Twitter questions on Twitter, that's totally fine. I'm not trying to discourage that. So like, I'm happy to help as much as I can, but like just as a general policy, right? And hang on Twitter. I made these slides months ago before Elon Musk ruined Twitter. maybe cross this one out. I don't know where, like, the problem is that it's still, I think, the best place to meet other developers. Like, it's just where most developers hang out. So I don't necessarily have an alternative. Maybe some Discord communities are really useful for this. Essentially, this should say hang out where people are, like hang out where developers are. Because just by being in communities, you build relationships. And the fact that all of you in this course together, and that's one of the major benefits to courses like this, is you're building relationships that will help you. Like, actually, the third job that I got at Breather, I got that job in part because someone I was at the boot camp with got a job there, and they referred me, and they said, yeah, like, this person really knows this stuff. And, you know, I had to go through the technical interview process like anybody else, and so I still had to prove that I was good at it, but it did certainly help me get that initial foot in the door. All right, learning effectively. I'm going to just like link to this blog post for this one, because I don't want to spend too much time on this. And I think actually this blog post does a pretty good job. What I'll say quickly is that I think a lot of people fall into the trap of you do a tutorial, you're following the tutorial pretty well. You get to the end of the tutorial and you say, okay, now let me try building my own thing. And you have no idea where to start. Like the tutorials are often very good at teaching you how to do the tutorial, but they're not so good at helping you build the generalized skills for like, how do I take the knowledge I've gotten in this project and apply it much more broadly? And this blog post is a bunch of different strategies for how to get around that, essentially. So like one idea is to make intentional mistakes. So like you're going through the tutorial and the tutorial says, add this chunk of code. And a thing I like to do is like, what if I change this code in some way? Like, what if I remove a line of code that is obviously important because it was included in there? What happens? And can I anticipate how it's going to break? Like, probably I'm going to get an error. Can I tell what the error is going to be? Or maybe that's a bit of an oversimplified example, but like, if it says set the variable to count plus one, what if I make count minus one? Or what if I do like count times two? Like, does the application change in the way I expect when I deviate from this tutorial? Another example is extending tutorials. So, you know, going from like building a tic-tac-toe game to building an entirely different game, or like building a calendar application, that's tricky. But maybe you can add new features to this game where you're already comfortable with the code base, you just went through this tutorial, you understand more or less how it works. That's a good way to go beyond what has been explicitly covered. And I'm also realizing now, like, you all are in this program, presumably a lot of these same ideas are being covered, and there are similar strategies, so this may all be redundant. But yeah, you can totally go through this blog post. Mindset is also a really big one. I'll go through this quickly because I think it's important. One of the most valuable things you can do as a developer is to really get comfortable failing, and not to see failure as a personal fault or something you should be ashamed of, or something that implies that you are not good enough or not smart enough. Failure is how we learn, right? All of us with everything. the way I phrase this in the blog post is, I'm terrible at bowling. And a few years ago, I went bowling with some of my friends, and literally I was the worst person in the group. Like every single ball that I threw was in the gutter. And, you know, the way that I did interpret this scenario at the time was, bowling is not my thing. Like, I am terrible at this. I want this to be over. I never want to bowl again. This is just not something I will ever be able to do. But I think a more realistic perspective for that is like, of course I'm not good at this. I've done it like 3 times in my life and I hadn't done it in years. If I wanted to, I could come every week into the bowling alley and I would get better and better, and I could be the best person in this group if I wanted to. I don't really want to, but, you know, having that mindset shift of like, all those gutter balls are training you what not to do. And that's the way to build real, like, mechanical knowledge for how these things work. You learn so much more from struggling at something than you do from effortlessly succeeding at it. Because if you already, like, if you're not in the habit, like, if you're really averse to being challenged, then you will not challenge yourself and you'll stay within your comfort zone and you'll do the stuff that you already know how to do. And that's not really helping you grow. Like, you sort of need the adversity of struggling something, but it doesn't have to be like, it doesn't have to make you feel terrible about yourself. Like, it's never going to be fun. I'm not saying that struggling is ever fun, but it becomes more a part of the process, the bad part of the process, rather than like a sign that you are not cut out for this, if that makes sense. Anyway, again, this blog post is linked in the final slide, which we have reached. So I'll also, oh yeah, I do have my portfolio book. No, I don't. Yeah, I do, this one over here. So all of those important things are linked in here. Yeah, questions. I don't know, Sally, how this usually, I'll let you run this.
Thank you, that was great. I am going to turn the recording off now, everyone.